Hey Matteo, I'm one of the organizers of the Machine Learning Meetup. And what I'm presenting is the work, actually, the work of my master thesis, done with my supervisor, Davide Baciu, and it's about tomography reconstruction with end-to-end neural networks.
Matteo, sorry if I interrupt you.
Yes.
There is a, I don't know, there is a sound on your microphone. I don't know.
Ah.
Yeah. Your
Okay.
microphone is like the sound is a little when.
Is it better now?
No, we can hear some noise. I think it's the microphone. No, please, could you? Can you speak now to
Yes, can you hear me now?
Yes, okay. Continue with the presentation. Thank you.
Okay, sorry. So, computed tomography is used in medical imaging, and basically the machine used for computed tomography is depicted here on the left. And how it works is that there is as depicted here, a X-ray emitter here and X-ray detectors on the other side. And basically, X-rays are emitted from here and go to the patient's body and are captured by the detector on the other side. And this whole structure rotates in order to take measurements from different angles. And so this transformation allows to reconstruct the interior of the body. So this is an image of a slice of a body, so you can see the interior. And basically what the sensor measure by taking measurements from all around the body is called a sinogram and is depicted in this image. And the idea is that this transformation can be described mathematically by a radon transform, which is defined by this formula here. And this formula is, of course, continuous. If we work on images, we need to discretize it and we obtain a linear transformation. So if we describe our image as a vector X, what we have is simply a matrix vector product, where Y is this sinogram that we measure from our sensor. So the idea is that we are given a noisy measurement of Y and we want to reconstruct the original X. And this task is hard because A is very large, very sparse matrix, and very bad condition. So even a small amount of noise on Y can create a lot of noise on X. And another operation which is useful is called radon back projection. So it's the transpose operation. So you just transpose the matrix. And for example, here you start with this, you do forward projection. With back projection, you obtain something like this, so a very blurry image. So of course, this is not inversion, it's just transpose operation. Okay, so this problem is part of a bigger class of problems called linear inverse problems. So we are problems defined like this. And these problems include many other interesting problems like image deblurring, image deconvolution, and related to tomography is sparse angle tomography and limited angle tomography. So, in theory, there is a very good algorithm for tomography reconstruction, which is called the filtered back projection. And in the ideal setting, it reconstructs perfectly the original signal, but it's very sensitive to noise because it amplifies high frequency detail. So if there is a little bit of noise on the measurements Y, we get very, very bad reconstructions. And the idea is that we take each line of the sinogram and apply a linear filtration to it, and then use back projection in order to get back an image. So the task we focus on is noisy tomography reconstruction. This task is useful because noise comes from having, for example, less intense X-rays. So this can be useful to reduce the amount of X-rays required for CT exams, so to make exams faster and reducing the risk of high X-ray exposure. This problem is also challenging because the radon transform is a condition, and therefore the reconstruction approach, the reconstruction process amplifies the noise, making it much, much worse. Okay, let me skip this slide. So most models, existing models that use machine learning, what they do is they start with a reconstruction computed with filtered back projection, so a noise reconstruction, and then apply a neural network as a denoiser to compute a denoised reconstruction. Instead, what we propose is to use an end-to-end model. So we give to the neural network the original measurements, noisy measurements, and combine the reconstruction and denoising process into a single model, so that directly from sensor readings create the final reconstruction. So why this is a good idea? Because it avoids the amplification of noise caused by filtered back projection. Because for example, here, you start from something very, very bad and then you try to fix it. Instead here, you don't first reconstruct, increase the noise and then the noise, but you combine everything into a single model. And also because sinograms exhibit a lot of structure, and so a neural network, like a convolutional neural network, can be used to denoise them and to analyze and filter them. So how to design this model? This is even depicts the classic pipeline of applied machine learning. So there is the noisy sinogram, a fixed linear filtration such as filtered back projection is applied to get a filtered sinogram. This sinogram is back projected to create a noisy reconstruction. And then the reconstruction is denoised by a neural network. So what we do, instead of having a fixed linear filtration, we use another learned model here. And instead of having a single channel of sinogram, we get multiple channels. So basically what we get is two neural networks connected by a random back projection. But random back projection is a linear operation and is differentiable. So we can view this whole system as a single large neural network, which can be trained end-to-end from noisy measurements to denoising constructions. So here in this big model, we have random back projection as an operation inside our neural network. So we need a good implementation. Existing implementation like Astra Toolbox are not fit for this task because they are not integrated with the deep learning frameworks. I have no support for batch operations and are designed to be used from the CPU point of view. So they always copy data back to the CPU. So if you are training a model on the GPU, so you have batches of data already on the GPU, this copy is very expensive and slow. So what we do is that we develop a PyTorch extension written in CUDA that implements radon transforms, that has all the features we need, so batch operation is integrated with automatic differentiation and always work on the GPU avoiding copies. And also because these operations are memory bound, we also add the support for our precision training, which is commonly used in machine learning in order to make the library even faster. And so this plot showed the speed of Astra and radon, torch radon. So here we can see the number of images computed transformed in a second. And the library, especially when using high precision, is much, much faster, being more than two order of magnitude faster than Astra Toolbox. And here we have different types of projection, like parallel projection and funding projection, both forward and backward. So the library was released on GitHub and is open source under an open source license, and implements also parallel projection, funding projection, but also noise emulation and shielded transfer. It is designed to be used for machine learning as a standard neural network layer, but it can also be used for iterative algorithms. Basically, you can take an iterative algorithm, some other kind of algorithm, implement it with TorchRadon to make use of its speed and to make use of batch processing and GPUs. And this library has also been used in published research by Cambridge University. So our task is to basically do noise tomography reconstruction. So we need to simulate the noise in our dataset. And what we do is we model three types of noise, which are shot noise, electronic noise, and quantization errors. So shot noise basically is because of the nature of the measurement process. While electronic noise is because it's created while reading values from the sensor, and quantization errors is the error we make because we need to store this data with a finite bit precision. So here this formula shows how we emulate the noise, and we use the 10 bits precision, which is commonly used by sensors. So we start with a serogram, here is X, without noise, and we get noise sensor readings R, which are integer values in this range. So we need a way to get back from noisy sensor readings to a noisy sinogram. And for doing this, there are three approaches, basically. The first is very simple. It is done, for example, by Astra Toolbox. And it's simply to try to take this formula and go back, so invert it in a way. But this is problematic because if the reading is zero, you get a logarithm of zero, so it's problematic. A better approach is to use Bayesian estimation to create a lookup table. So basically you use your data set as a prior and you compute these expected values, which you can pre-compute just once because the different values that R can take is limited because it's just integers in this range. So it's a small range of values. And you just pre-compute a lookup table and then use it to estimate the value of the sinogram. And also by using this formula, you can estimate basically the variance. So it's like a confidence level in what you are estimating. Okay, the third way, which is the better way, is to take this idea of the lookup table and take it a little bit farther. So instead of using a lookup table, which is fixed, use a word embedding layer, and then followed by a classic convolutional neural network, and then train the neural network to directly predict these two quantities, mu and sigma, and this creates much better results. For example, here we can see a sinogram, the noisy measurement. So this is done with this Bayesian lookup table. It's very noisy. Here instead is the estimate done by the neural network, which estimates the mean and the variance. And you can see that the variance is higher where there are sharp features, for example here, or where there is the sinogram is a higher value. So this means there is a more dense body because this is due to the Poisson distribution of noise. So our model is composed by two UNet networks. So, and it's depicted in this picture. We start with noise sensor readings here. We use our word embedding layer as explained before. And there is the first network, Radon back projection, and the second neural network. So The idea is that these two networks are instances of the UNet model. The idea of the UNet is that you take your input, you process it, and then each block reduces the resolution of the input in order to aggregate spatial information and to reduce the computational cost. And then here in this part, you do the opposite. So instead you keep re-upscaling the data and use skip connection. So you take the output of the previous block, at the same resolution, and you connect it with the current block in order to get back the information you lose by downscaling and then upscaling. And this is what is generally used for image denoising and also for other tasks in machine learning. And the idea is that this kind of model is efficient because working at lower resolution with downscaling is faster, allows each neuron in the output to see basically the entire input. And by making use of skip connections, also gradients can flow without problems. So the optimization is fast, it's quite easy. And then there is a second UNet that filters the image, because there is here the output is synogram, gets best projected to get an image. And then here this is filtered by this second UNet, which is basically the same. And the two simple kind of layers that we use are residual block, which is a well-known kind of layer. So the idea is that you take an input and you apply convolutions, classic convolution, normalization, activation, convolution, normalization. And then it's called residual because then you sum back the input x and then apply the final activation. So here the idea is that instead of computing something totally different, you just compute a change that you apply to x and you apply it by summing. And this makes the loss landscape much smoother. So optimization is easier. Here instead is another module that we use, which is channel attention. So the idea is that we use mean pooling. So we take the mean over all spatial locations in order to aggregate information. With this aggregate information, we compute with these layers, basically a weight. And then we apply this weight to each channel. So what the model is doing is taking like the whole image and then weighting each channel by its importance. And this is very useful, especially when we need to reduce the number of channels. It's useful to use channel attention to first reweight and then combine the channels. Okay, so the idea is that this model presented is a simple model that takes noisy synogram as input and then produces a single reconstruction as output. We also develop a different type of model, which is a generative model. So the idea is that instead of having like a single reconstruction, we get the ability to sample different reconstructions. And this can be useful for different things. For example, by sampling different reconstructions and comparing them, for example, even just by watching at them, we can quantify uncertainty. So get an idea of how uncertain we are in making a certain reconstruction. Or we can use, for example, a generative model to generate a lot of reconstructions, analyze them with another neural network, for example, to find the lesion, and then aggregate these predictions to get like a probability estimate of having a lesion. So you get a lot of images, you, for example, in 80% of them, there is a lesion. So you say, okay, 80% probability of having a lesion, even if the data is very noisy. And this model can be adapted to use to do iterative improvement of reconstructions. So basically the idea is that we need a loss to train this kind of model. And the idea is to start with something which is done classically for linear inverse problems in mathematics, which is called variational regularization. So the idea is that you start with an X, generally is zero, and you try to minimize this this loss. This loss is composed by a data term here. It's just saying how much what you reconstruct, so X, is consistent with what you measure, so Y. And here there is a regularizer that promotes some properties on X. So in our ideal case, what we mean is that what we construct should be consistent with the noisy data we measure, of course, given the noise, but should also be a realistic image, not a noisy image. Okay, so we start with this formulation and then we modify it in order to get to our final loss that we use for training the model. So the first thing that we do is here in the data term, we make use of our noise model. So here, instead of epsilon, which we don't have, we have mu, so our estimate. And here, instead of weighting each pixel in the same way, we use our estimate sigma, as described in this formula, to weight each pixel of the synonym. So the idea is that if we are very certain about, for example, a certain pixel, we need to be very close with our reconstruction on that pixel. If we're uncertain, we can be even, the error can be larger. So the second change is that instead of using a fixed regularizer like here, we change it and we use a neural network, so a discriminator, which is what is done with general model, generative models in general, generative adversarial networks. So we don't have like a fixed formula for computing if an image is realistic or not, but we learn a machine learning model. And to train the discriminator, we make use of the WGAN framework with spectral normalization in order to enforce the constraint on the Lipschitz norm. Then here, the idea in Bayesian regularization is to find and optimize over X. Instead, what we do is we introduce a generator that takes two parameters. One is the sensor readings, and the other one is Z, which is a free parameter. So the idea is that instead of optimizing over Z, we can optimize here directly over Z, which is much easier because Z is much smaller, and because the model is trained and is trained also to look at sensor readings. We don't start with a random guess, but we start already with a good guess of the reconstruction. Okay, so if you train a model like this, okay, this can be used like as a loss to train the generator, G. But what happens is that the generator learns to ignore Z. So if you change Z, you still get the same reconstruction. Instead, the idea would be that you sample different Z and get different reconstruction. The problem here is that there is nothing here trying to tell to G, okay, if you get different Z, you need to create different reconstructions. So, okay, we do something which is a little bit complicated, but I hope to convince you of the intuition. So the idea is that at training time, we take two samples of Z here, Z1 and Z2, create with a generator two reconstructions, and then transform them into a synonym. So what we want is that we want these two synonyms to be different, and the difference needs to be quantified by this variance that we have estimated. So what we do is that we take these two synonyms, we fit a normal distribution on them, and then compare it to a normal distribution with the parameter mu and sigma using the KL divergence. So okay, the formula is a little bit complicated, but we get this final loss here that has three components. The first is a data term, basically as before. So what it does is says, okay, what you reconstruct needs to be consistent with what you measure, so this mu. Here we have this discriminator as before. So it says, okay, you need to create a reconstruction, which is a realistic image, and then without noise. And then we have this additional term. And what this does is say, okay, the difference between these two scenograms needs to be similar to what is estimated by this sigma of R. So this ensures the variation between samples, and so avoids mode collapse, so avoid the G ignoring Z. Okay, so this is the architecture of the generator, and is very similar to the previous model. The only difference is that instead of giving to R, R to the model, we also give Z. And this Z is given near the end of the model, because what we want to do if we do iterative improvement is that we want to optimize over Z. So we need to compute the gradient from here to here. So if, for example, we had to given Z here, we had to backpropagate the gradient all the way through all the model. Instead here, we just need to backpropagate from here to here, which is much faster. So this Z is given to this block, which I call modified block. And basically the idea is that if we have, for example, a scenogram with a lot of noise, we want our reconstruction to be a lot different between each other. Instead, if we have basically no noise, we want our reconstruction to be always the same. So the idea is that the neural network should weight the parameter Z before feeding it to the next layers. So basically what we do is that we split the channels and use some channels to compute a weight using an exponential activation. We multiply Z by this weight in order to scale it, to scale the effect of Z, and then just concatenate it back and feed it to the rest of the block. So this way, the neural network can basically express uncertainty in the reconstruction and decide how much it cares about Z. Okay, so some results. First results for the end-to-end model, the reconstruction model. So we compare a model that use fitted back projection followed by a neural network with model that use an end-to-end neural network. We measure four quantities. Okay, one is the number of parameters, so the size of the model. Here is the number of frames per second, so the speed. So of course, here we want a higher speed. These are two quality measures for images, structural similarities and fixed signal to noise ratio. And this is better to be higher is better for these measures. So what we can see is that if we take, okay, we have different sizes of models. And in general, end-to-end models achieve a little bit better reconstruction accuracy while using a lot less parameters and being faster. Here, for example, if you take the smallest not end-to-end model, it is just slightly smaller than the larger end-to-end model. So we save a lot of parameters using the end-to-end structure, and we are also quite faster because there's not the problem of increasing the noise and then denoising, but it's just more efficient to do it in a single model. Okay, then the various components have been validated using an ablation study. So basically we train different variants of the model, one with all the features and then other variants without a single one of these blocks. And then we see that if we drop even one of them, the accuracy is affected. Okay, so these are the results for the generative model. So we can see here the filtered back projection reconstruction. Here the original image, and these are all different samples from the degenerative model. So of course here we have a lot of noise, so it's basically impossible to see anything. So we can see that there is quite a lot of variation between these reconstructions, and all these reconstructions, even if there is a lot of noise, all look realistic. Then if we start to increase the X-ray intensity, so the noise is reduced, we can start to see something, for example here. And so all the reconstructions agree in this area and also have like less variation. So if we then increase again the signal intensity, we can see that the reconstruction start to converge to the original image. So what the model is doing is the right thing, because as information becomes more precise, the model converges to the same reconstruction. So to conclude, we've shown that end-to-end models can improve performance of tomographic reconstruction, and also shown how this architecture can be used to create generative models. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.